إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس واتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم وما يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إن خير الحديث كتاب الله خير الهدي هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد يقول الله عز وجل قد أفلح من زكاها Whoever purifies themselves, they're successful. Purity is of various types. Physical purity, emotional purity, purity firstly on the belief of the person, aqidah of the person. So purifying a person in various level makes the person successful. Suila Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked in the hadith in Sahih Tirmidhi that whichever act which takes the most people to the paradise. Which act takes the most of the people to the paradise? فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ تَقْوَى اللَّهُ وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقُ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ Fear of Allah Azza wa Jal, being conscious about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in addition to that, a person who has good characters, good manners, good behaviors, they're the one going to paradise. That simply tells me and you that it is not only the recitation of the Quran, it is not only Qiyamul Layl, it is not only fasting Monday the Thursdays, in addition to those things, we have to do some other things to go to the paradise. If that was not the case, Islam would have been based on pure rituals. Islam would have been based upon pure rituals. That is not the case. That is not the case. Rasulullah ﷺ used to make da'a himself, his name in Ibn Hibban, that Allahumma hassanta khalki, فَحَسِّنْ خُلِكِ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ Allah, you have made myself nice, beautiful, right, in appearance, and make my character likewise. So character has an important role to play in a Muslim's life. For example, making salah. قال الله عز وجل that إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ Salah is a ritual, must be done in a proper manner upon Kitab Sunnah. Fact remains that salah must produce a result also, which is protect the person from bad and evil stuff. If that doesn't do it, you still have to pray, but I have to understand that I'm missing something. I have to understand I'm missing something. And those things must be relevant to Muslim life. What I understand, in my humble understanding, Muslim world today got so engrossed, engulfed with external rituals, they forgot the essence of it. They forgot the essence, the objective of something. Like people busy fasting, which is a good thing to do. وَلَكِنْ فَاسْتْ مَسْتْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ Taqwa must be an output of fasting. You go to work every day, you have no paycheck. So you wonder, why I'm coming to work? What is the outcome of it? So a Muslim prays and fasts, but acts like somebody else beside Muslim. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خالف المشركين. This hadith is resonated across the Muslim world, but we are the first one to follow them. In action. My behavior reflects my deen. We are the faceplate of our religion. Every house has a number. Every house has a number, has a faceplate, the door. That tells you which house is this. So likewise, as a Muslim, we are faceplate of our religion. If you look at ourselves, it doesn't reflect religion. Many people say it is aqidah and manhaj book. kibar of the ulama, the point is that it is the belief along with the method applicated on people's life, applicable to people's life. So therefore, it is not only the belief, the action along with that. This deen, this is the belief of us, of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. It is not only what comes out of your tongue, the action which manifests along with the belief. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. This comes in conjunction. Therefore, this religion is not only talk. As we understand, action is louder than words. But today Muslims are far, far away from this. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق. كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم أخرجه إمام البخاري. That I've been sent to this dunya with an objective, which is to rectify the character, a behavior of people. We came, Prophet ﷺ came with a mission. Mission is change, transform a generation of people from Jahiliyyah to Islam. But many of us, to us, Islam means Islamic clothing, so-called Islamic clothing. Which I must insist that wearing this practically has nothing to do with religion. Wearing this also practically has nothing to do with religion. Having a name Abdullah, practically speaking, in days of Jahiliyyah, people also had the name Abdullah. People also wear some kind of Arabian clothing. People also ate dates. People lived in Mecca. For example, Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. So living in Mecca, speaking some Arabic, having a name, it doesn't tell you that you're Muslim. What tells you're Muslim? How you carry yourself. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with the message, إِنَّمَا بُعِثُ لُكُتَمِّمَ مَكَرِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ كَمَا قَالَ صلى الله عليه وسلم, I came to rectify the character of the people. People in Arabian Peninsula used to be racist, used to be oppressive, used to violate the right of people. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, transformed the same group of people to something else. They spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are just with people. They care for people. They give the rights of an animal. Forget about the human. That's far above it. But Muslims today, you go around the world, look at the Muslims. You tell me where we belong. Many people ask, brother, why the situation of the Muslim is as bad as today? Surah Ar-Rum, Surah number 30. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, زَارَ الْفَسَادَ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. The calamities on the land and the sea. It is because what the people have under their own hand. It is we who brought down upon ourselves. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. Allah never does injustice to his servant. So if it is a problem, I have earned it. لَهَ مَا كَسَبَتْ وَعَلَيْهِ مَا اكْتَسَبَتْ. Whatever you earn, that is upon yourself. So as a Muslim, we need to see what we are. What bothers me the most? What bothers me the most, people take religion, read a lot of books, translate a lot of hadith, and read the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, and transmit to the people, but they forgot the message of the religion. A Muslim, for example, is a trustworthy Muslim. If I give you $50,000, say, brother, fear Allah, I'm giving it to you, give it back to me after 7 days. I can never believe you will not give it to me. I will never believe that. Otherwise, I won't be hanging with you. I won't be hanging with you if I can't believe that you're Muslim. Muslims today are the most corrupt. You go across the Muslim world, most divided nation. Anything you name on the book in evil, Muslims someplace, some country are doing it. Whether at the level of the government or the layman level, regardless. What is the issue of this Muslim today? Because Rasulullah ﷺ already predicted this hadith and prophesied it. He said, there will come a time this ummah will be humiliated to the low of low. The Sahabas were confused, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, that what is the reason behind it? Because we are small in number, in Badr 300 plus only. Only 300 plus. In fact, in Mecca, about 10,000 plus. Only this few people. Allah gave us victory. What will happen to those generation of people? They will be lowest of the low. Rasulullah said, the Sahaba's concern, are they small in number? Kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bal antum yawma idhin kathir. That day you will be huge in number, large in number. So what is the problem then? 1.5 billion Muslims, hundreds of Muslim countries, landmass, human resources and wealth, everywhere. What is the problem? Kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hubbu dunya وكرهت الموت كما قال. So حب الدنيا, that is what I want to talk about. Why I'm going to deceive you, my brother? You want to buy a car? I'm saying the car is so good, even the car is not good, because I want to make some money out of it. The dunya. كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من غش فليس مني. This hadith, context of the hadith is this: Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم was walking in a marketplace. A man was selling some grain, you know, grain, barley, rice, this kind of stuff. So he صلى الله عليه وسلم put his hand into the grain and felt something wet under it. The wet grain, which is soaked in rain, is under the dry grain in the top. So dry stuff, nice looking stuff in the top, and the bad stuff in the bottom. He صلى الله عليه وسلم told the person, why did not you put this stuff in the top? So people, customers, can make an assessment, an honest assessment, that what is the quality of the grain I'm buying. So one hadith says, man ghasha falaysa minni, whoever deceives us. Another hadith says, whoever deceives me is not among me, or among us, the Muslims. Deception. This is one of the key elements in the political world of the Muslims, from the top to the lowest level, somebody lying. Somebody begging, making up stories and begging. Muslims, making up story, brother, this happened to my family, can I get $10? Lying to beg. And the top level in the government, they're also doing the same in different form of fashion. But fact remains, Muslim in general lost their goal. Muslim in general lost their direction. It is all the way from the top to the bottom. But this doesn't hurt me. A liar is supposed to lie. A fake person cannot be trusted. That's understandable. That is not the character of Muslims. Rasulullah said, behave with the people, engage with the people, set an example of goodness with the people in the society. We don't hate the people, but we don't follow their bad. We don't follow their bad. If a non-Muslim helps the poor, we also help the poor. What we hate about that? Speaking with some sense, not rhetoric, copying, pasting from other documents, to make sense when we speak. Muslims are intelligent people. They reflect and think. Allah said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَقْفَالُهَا. Don't you reflect? Don't you think? Or you have a lock in your heart? You can't think anymore. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَىٰ الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِكَتْ. Allah said, don't you see? Don't you reflect? What is the problem with people? Because we're into recitation, we're into memorization, which is good, but not good enough. Like somebody cooked a food, put inside the box, and licking outside of the box. Let me repeat what I just said. You cook some food, put in a box, now you're licking the box from outside to taste the food. You can never taste this food. You have to open the box. Many Muslims today took the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a ritualistic thing. They just touch it, repeat it. In their life, doesn't reflect anything of it. By the way, if you open Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 177, it's a famous ayah, every Muslim know it, ayah of Laysal Bir. If you read the ayah in a careful manner, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, Laysal Bir an tuwallu ujuhakum qibla al-mashrik wal-maghrib, walakin al-bir. It is not piety, it is not righteousness to face yourself towards the east or the west. Please no, you still have to face for your salat al qibla. It is not saying that you don't do that, simply saying this is not enough. We have to understand, this ayat is simply saying, this is not enough. It doesn't say you don't have to pray. It says you have to pray, but it's not enough. In addition to that, what you have to do, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِ الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ وَالسَّائِلِينَ فِي الرِّقَابِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَالْمُوفُونَ بِأَحْدِهِمْ إِذَا أَحَدُوا. Muslim, that you give for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the poor, to your needy, to your family members, and you do many other things. Towards the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِأَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَهَدُوا. That you must keep your word when you give somebody a word. I give, may Allah forgive all of us. We all have deficiencies. May Allah forgive us and them, whoever they are. The point here is, the Muslim must understand, we have some obligation to act like Muslim beside recitation of the Quran. Because as a Muslim, we have some obligation to do something. We make social reform. We change the society by people looking at us without even talking. You want to buy a car from me? I say, brother, this car has oil leak problem. But the person says, I don't see any leak. You don't see, but I know about it. Even though it's not there, but I know about it. So I'm telling you in advance. He said, what's your name? My name is Muhammad. He said, I heard about the Muslims. They're very honest. So you prove that point to me. This is Muslim. Say, brother Muslim, don't tell me about it, man. This guy took the money from me, said, giving me 1 week later, he's gone. He's gone, I didn't see him after 6 years. Brother, it happened to me, I'm not talking to somebody else. Brother took from me. And talk about manhaj, talk about akidah, akhi. Those stories, put in a book. Close the book now. You give a lot of talk. What is the action? Sister, you fasting, doing qaymul layl, but anytime you start, you backbite. Allah made this haram for you. In Surah Al-Hujurat, Surah number 49, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the haram for you to backbite other people. It's haram. But you are the same person stayed qaymul layl, fasting Mondays and Thursdays. Those are mustahab. Good to do it. Walakin, this is wajib for you to stop backbiting. This is practical Islam. You go to making hajj every month. Sorry, umrah every month. Right? Because you love Allah so much. You come to your business, you indulge your riba. Allah made it haram for you. A Muslim must reflect their Islam in character, in behavior, in financial transaction, in family life. This is your deen. What is deen supposed to mean? Some storybook? Deen is a practical implementation of Allah and Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in your life. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala was asked about Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who khuluqul Qur'an, he is the embodiment of the Qur'an. So if you did not read the Qur'an, you look at Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his life should tell you what is in the Qur'an. How he talk, how he behave, how he give the right of the people, his kindness, his manners, and this is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But many people confine the deen. This brother did not say Ameen after Surah Fatiha. It is important, but that's not wajib. When you finished the Ameen, you came in the street, brother, I saw you how you deal with yourself, akhi. Your Ameen mean nothing to me because your Ameen, your Salah, confined within the masjid, the behavior of the Salah, diminish as soon as you come outside. Your life should be carried in Islam. La ilaha illallah, not in the masjid, inside your business. La ilaha illallah, in your school. If la ilaha illallah was not in the business, read Surah Al-Jum'ah, the second last ayah. يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. You're in a business, in your job, stop the job. In your business, there's la ilaha illallah. You're selling some stuff, don't cheat, don't deceive others. Your la ilaha illallah is there. مَنْ غَشَّ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Whoever deceive others, they are not part of the group of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you are not from the part of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose group do you belong to? Whose group do you belong to? A believer Islam must be an embodied thing in the life of the people. When I get angry, all of us get, some have a short temper, like I have a short temper. Man came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, that Awsini, give me an advice. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la tahdar, don't be angry. So I got the message, what else? La tahdar, don't get angry. You research the matter. What anger can do. You angry, say, divorce my wife. Or break the glass. Or shoot somebody. It can do wild stuff because of anger. So Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had the insight. The social reform came through this deen. That's why people used to hate each other. Ansar and Muhajir, they become brother in Medina. What they did, to share half of their wealth. Please know, lecture and reading this on paper is easy. You give me half of your wealth, what do you mean? You have $100,000 in your bank, you give me $50,000. It's for real? I give you $50, I'll give you a ride, or buy some halal food from the store, but not $50,000. But these people understood the deen, radiallahu ta'ala anhum. They embodied the truth within themselves, and they understood the meaning of it, ukhwa. That's why the half of the wealth of the brother from the Ansar went to Muhajir. This is not a random event. This is not a spontaneous event. This is a systematic culturing a generation to come to the rise to the challenges of this dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated these people. Allah says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنْصَارِ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُونَ. Allah has elevated their status. Allah recognized them. Allah didn't recognize you and me. The point is this, we're not acting like them. الَّذِينَ اتَّبَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ. And those follow their lifestyle with sincerity, with goodness, they will be also, Allah will be pleased with them also. The point is, are we doing it? Well, my feeling is those don't pray, those don't fast, those who don't do this, that, that's another discussion. My concern, those who are fasting, those are doing qiyam al-layl, those are wearing hijab and niqab. Religion has very little to do with external appearance, by the way. A munafiq can give a shah. So the point here is, Religion has very little to do with external appearance. It's not the case. Many people think, the point is, many people think wearing thobe is something extremely religious. Beard is only religious thing you can do. Folding the pants is only religious thing you do. Yes, you ought to do them, yes. But that is not the only thing you're supposed to do. You miss the point. If that is the case, anybody can wear this. Anybody can grow beard. Anybody can put a kufi on. But not everybody can follow the lifestyle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Allah said, وَلَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. Those who want to go back to Allah and His Prophet, for them, there is a good example in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to follow his life, not only his words, his life. So Muslims today, so much chaos. So many years ago, back in days, about 20 some years ago, I went to a lecture by a sheikh, whom I know very close. So I asked him, that was I think 1995, I asked him, Sheikh, why the Ummah has so much problem? That was 95, we didn't have that much problem. But that time I said, what is it? He said, brother, rather than asking why the Ummah of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has so much problem, ask yourself, what level of contribution are you making to the problem? You get my point? He said, ask yourself, what level of contribution have you made to the problem? So I look at myself now, self-rectification, قَدْ أَفْلَهَا مَنْ زَكَّهَا. So I come home, I have to think, what did I do for this ummah to come to this level? What am I missing? Rituals, you're praying, fine. You're fasting, fine. Your recitation, fine. Memorizing hadith, fine. Memorizing Quran, fine. But what else? If that was the only thing, everybody would recite Quran in their houses, Islamic society wouldn't be built. Where the law of Allah will be established? In free space? In moon? Within the people. The people have to be cultured, educated, trained to come to that level. Otherwise, they revolt against their own government because they are not trained for that. This is an academic process. Knowledge is by learning. So this is an academic process. But bad part is this, Muslims' academic increase so many. You ask yourself, and I ask myself, time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or from the Tabi Tabi, the first three generations, خَيْرُ قُرُونِ كَرَنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلَمُونَ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلَمُونَ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. First three generation, how many mufassirin you had? And today, but where is the ummah today with all the academic excellence? We're still going down. Something is missing. There is some disconnect somewhere. Muslim is separated from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are pretending to be Muslim. They are putting an appearance of Islam where the essence in the heart is missing. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the right path. Give us the understanding of it. If that is not the case, there is nobody else to guide us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only one. And in salah, say Allahumma ihdina sirata mustaqim. Every day, 17 times at the least, Allah guide us to the right path. We need it desperately. Now, if you look at the Muslims today, and somebody gave me a practical story, another Muslim country. A person looks so pious, subhanAllah. He said, I look at the person, I couldn't believe. I thought he's the Imam of the Masjid. Looks so pious by the appearance. He won't bribe, but he won't touch the money by hand. So he said, what? He opened the drawer, he said, leave the money in the drawer, I'm not going to touch it. But he's going to take it end of the day. He's going to take the money end of the day. What do you think? You're playing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a joke? You think this religion is a joke? Allah said, لا تتخذوا آيات الله هزوا. خُذُوا مَا أَتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ. What I give, take it serious. This is no joking matter. This deen is a serious deen. If you can't play with it, take the back seat. Let somebody come forward who is made for this job. So we have to understand, brothers and sisters, every Muslim, no matter what you are, where you live, what you have with you, there will come a time. There will come a time you're going to meet Malakul Maut, the angel of death. There will come a time, no matter who you are, where you are, what you studied, where you graduated from, how many books you read, you are going to meet the angel of death. That very moment, just to reflect on that. That moment, you're sitting down, you hardly can breathe. Imagine, are you willing to take so many crimes on our shoulder? That moment. My house, which I built on deception of others, stealing money from others, lying and cheating, that house I can't stay any longer in there. My children are going to take it. Was it worth it? For whom I'm going to lie? For whom I'm going to cheat and deceive other people and violate the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why should I do that? For what? You know that some Muslims tell me that the Muslim is the last person I can trust with money. If a Muslim is the last person I'm going to try with money, I can't trust. Why? Because we set an example of evil. lowliness, greediness. And this is the nature of the Muslims today. And that reflects why the Muslims are falling apart, because of this reason. Why the Muslims are fighting each other? Somebody want more power than others. Somebody want control over the resources. This is the same concept years after years. Started hundreds of years ago in Muslim Ummah. One generation, one dynasty killing the other dynasty. Why they want more power? Where is Allah in there? Nowhere. Some people fake it, pretend to be something about Allah, but it is something else, the dunya. Dunya is in the heart of the people. بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْمَالِ حُبٌّ جَمَّةٌ. You love the wealth so much. Allah says in Quran. This dunya is a trial for Muslims. Muslims today need to think, no matter what level we are in, whether you're the governor or a layman in the street, we need to think one day we'll meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One day we're going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Think about it. And we're going to say, مَا لِي هَذَا الْكِتَابِ. Surah Kahf, Surah Number 18. مَا لِي هَذَا الْكِتَابِ. لَا يَغَادِرِ صَغِيرَةَ وَلَا كَبِيرَةَ إِلَّا سَهَا. What kind of book is this? Nothing exempt from it. Everything is accounted for. Whether it's small or big. وَمَا يَلْفَظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. It is written on the book. You can't hide from it. اِقْرَأْ كِتَابِكَ فَبِنَفْسِكَ الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكَ حَسِيبٌ. Read your book and you tell me where it belongs. We ask Allah's protection from our own self. خُطْبَةُ الْحَاجَةِ. خُطْبَةُ الْحَاجَةِ we need to reflect on. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا وَمِنْ سَيِّئَاتِ أَعْمَالِنَا. Listen carefully. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ. This is not a story. Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم خطيب المسجد النبوي صلى الله عليه وسلم دار الحجرة says نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا. Who are the audience? Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم. Allah said رضي الله تعالى عنه ورضوان. These are the people. Say نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا. Who are the أنفسنا? جم the Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم. It's not you and me. نعوذ بالله من شرور. Well, we ask Allah's protection from the evil of our soul, from the evil of our bad deeds. Whose bad deeds? Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم. They are saying it. So how many times you and I supposed to say it? 100 million times. How many times we should reflect on it? Million times. Keep thinking what I'm not doing right. To conclude the matter, my brother, my sister, make it clear that money is the biggest fitna of this ummah. Inna li kulli ummati fitna, fitna ummati al-mal kama qal sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every nation has a trial. And trial and fitna of this nation is wealth. You see money, you lose directions. I love it. Who doesn't love it? بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْمَالِ حُبًّا جَمَّةً. You love it. بَلْ تُعْسِرُونَ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. You love the dunya, yes. وَلَكِنْ وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرُ وَأَبْقَى. Akhirah is better. Allah says, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ دَارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Whatever you have, put it together for akhirah, not for dunya. Allah is calling you towards Jannah. Where are you going? Allah says, أَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. Where are you going? لا ترجون لله وقارا. Why don't you come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Where are you heading to? Many khatib thinks speeches for others. Wallahi al-azim, speeches for the nafs. Allah says, kuwa anfusakum. Allah says, kuwa anfusakum, save yourself. If I'm not saved, you save, it doesn't matter to me. I love you, my brother, that's true. But yawm al-qiyamah is not a love show there. Yawm al-qiyamah, la yas'alu hamimun hamima. That day there is no love, friendship there. It is about me and nafsi. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِي. That day you for yourself. So if I'm not saved, what is the point giving lecture to you? So when I go home, I need to reflect, listen to this. I've been saying these things. What deficiencies do I have? Should I do? No doubt. But I need to identify a problem. Then have to chalk out a plan to rectify the problem. If you go to a doctor, does a blood test, if you cannot even identify the problem, how are you going to prescribe medication for it? So we need to identify. First, accept I have deficiencies. Who doesn't? Then I said, what are the deficiencies? Write it down. I don't find any deficiencies in myself. I'm so good, mashallah. So let me ask somebody else, brother, you are my mirror. You can see me, but I can't see myself. Tell me, brother, what you see weak in there. Tell me, be gentle or send me email or text. I may get offended. Send me a text and email, brother, these are the problems you have. Now I'm going to find out how to fix it. If I really love you, I'll tell you that. But Muslims today are not willing to take advice. They think they know life. This is the problem. That this is the beginning of journey until we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يقول الله عز وجل في سورة الحجر, Surah number 15, the last ayah, فَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيكَ الْيَقِينَ. Be obedient to Allah. Make ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until you die. This is the journey. Islam, many people think it's a destination. Mm-mm. Islam is the journey. Destination is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam is a journey. You have to live Islam every day. It's not a one day. I graduated from Azhar, degree from Medina. I said, that's good. I have a PhD from fiqh in Lebanon, mashallah. That's a step towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's not a goal, that's a means. What is the goal? To live a life of Islam in every single day in my life. Till فَعَبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيكَ الْيَقِينِ. Till you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَاسْرَفْ عَنَّا بِأَمْرِنَا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانصُرْنَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. Those who know, those who don't know, I'd like to request you that Yawm al-Jum'ah, Friday, between Asr and Maghrib, there's a time dua is accepted. There's an ikhtilaf in this issue. And there's another text where it says, it is the time the imam comes in the minbar till the salah is finished, something like that. There's some differences of opinion in that. So what I do, make dua between the khutbah, as well as after Asr, between Asr and Maghrib. There is a time Allah will accept the dua. To ask Allah in a sincere manner, especially when it's raining, asking Allah that to forgive us, to guide, unite the heart of the Muslims. In addition to that, I have a personal request to you. I have a personal request. My father, Allahumma arhamhu, passed away a few months ago. I'd like you, please, for 10 seconds, simple dua, whenever possible, ask Allahumma aghfir lahu warhamhu wa'fihi wa'fu'anhu. Something simple, Allah forgive him. Not Arabic, English, Chinese, whatever. Allah understand everything, Allah forgive him. Have mercy on him, give him to paradise, that's all. I'm requesting, it doesn't cost anything, only 10 seconds. Please do make dua, Allah has commanded us to make dua for our parents. اللهم رب ارحمه ما كما ربنا صغيرا وقال هذا استغفر الله ولي ولكم ان الحمد لله والصلاه والسلام على رسول الله وعلى اله واصحابه ومن والاه. To conclude the matter, the Muslim warats are some of the characters we should have. You know the hadith, without going into details, one pious lady oppressed a cat and cat ended up dying. The lady was penalized by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the hadith. Animal rights. Being crude, rude to animal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a human into hell for injustice to an animal. You need to think this. This is not storytelling. To think a right of an animal and a human pious go to hell for a right of an animal, doesn't make sense. What that's supposed to mean to me? I have to think. You have to think. You reflect on it. Another, you know, one prostitute, a bad lady, be kind to a dog, Allah forgive her sin. You know that? Animal rights to justice. If an animal deserves justice and kindness, a Muslim from a Muslim deserves more than that. And look at the Muslims today fighting every part of the world. Whatever the reason, I don't care, I don't want to listen on it. Everybody thinks they're right, beside the point. But how did it come to this stage? Why did not we stop this from the beginning? The dunya, dunya, dunya in the heart of the people. Started from the a'imma, this generation, the rulers, to the huffaz, to the imams, to the scholars, everybody in a game now. Everything has become a game. Everything for the dunya, they use the Islam as a tool. This has become the problem of the ummah today. And money has become the greatest fitna of this ummah. We need to be careful. I know one sheikh, Hafizahullah, about 10 years ago, he gave advice to another imam. I was there, it's one in the morning, we had an issue. So he told another imam, he said, brother, I was advised by my sheikh, never touch the money. The money, because this is the essence of problem. Just everything comes from it. Now, good behavior. As a Muslim, we've got to be good of your neighbors. Rasulullah said in another hadith, Jibreel came to him and was insisting on the right of the neighbor so much, he was concerned they may end up getting the right of inheritance. The rights of your neighbor. Cursing, yelling, taking their parking spot. This is not Muslim behavior. All adds up to be something so wrong, people don't like us anymore. He said, you people are so peace, Islam is so peace, you're so kind, why are you guys all fighting together? I have no answer. I have no answer. Why are we at this stage? Because dunya has become important. So we need to calm down and think, what is my goal? What I'm heading to? What is wrong with me? How can I fix it? Good character, kindness. Rasulullah said in another hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ رَفِيقٌ يُحِبِّ الرِّفْقَ فِي أَمْرِ كُلِّهِ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Allah is gentle, loving and caring. He loves gentleness in everything. Try to be kind. Try to forgive others. So no, I'm not going to forgive him. Allah said, أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ يَفْرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Don't you love that Allah forgive you? Yes, so you forgive others too. A gentleness, caring, loving. You know, this deen is something different than what is in the news, what we're doing. We need to make an effort to change it. And every effort starts from nafs, from myself. Then to the next person. كُوْ أَنْفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ. From my family. كُوْ أَنْفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ. Then, أَنْدِرْ عَشِرَتِكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Then your neighbors. Not neighbors, your relatives. So me first, then I take my son. If I speak 2 hours outside, inside the house, at least 8 hours. Has to be, because that is my obligation. Kullukum ra'in, kullukum mas'ulun ar-ra'iyatihi, kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm responsible for my family members. And I'm going outside, giving a lot of talk outside. Allahumma sta'an. We need to change ourselves, come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah has commanded us to come to His deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, udkhulu fi silmi kafa, wa la tattabi khutwati shaitan, innahu lakum aduwwun mubin. O Muslims, come back to the religion of Allah 100%. Not only thawb, not only beard, not only maswak. The complete deen, your action must reflect you Muslim. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make us among those who embody the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the footsteps of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in every single detail. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Allahumma khfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa sabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala al-qawm al-kafirin. Allahumma ahsin aqibatana fi al-umuri kulliha wa ajirina min khizy al-dunya wa adab al-akhirah. Allahumma rabbi irhamhu ma kama rabbayani saghira. Aqim as-salam. Rahimahumullah.